Thank you. Thank you. I spent 7 years as a police officer and 22 years as a special agent with U.S. Secret Service. My job prior to retirement was I was the lead protective intelligence coordinator and threat assessment investigator for the Cleveland Field Office. So as you can imagine, the Secret Service spends a lot of time reviewing past incidents of attacks and attempted attacks so that we can tweak our security protocols to understand why they happen and prevent them from happening again. So what I wanted to start you out with is to give you kind of a history of presidential protection. So let's start out in 1789. The United States Marshals Service is the very first or oldest federal law enforcement agency. Now, ironically, President George Washington, our first president, assigned 13 U.S. Marshals to protect his attorney general. So he didn't have protection for himself by the federal government, which it's done today, per se, with federal law enforcement agencies. He assigned the marshals to protect his attorney general, who is the lead legal advisor. So how was presidential protection done at that time? It was loosely and sporadically done by local law enforcement officers and or the military. What do I mean by loosely and sporadically? Well, sometimes the president had these protection services, sometimes they did not. Fast forward to 1865, what was happening? Each state was designing and producing their own currency. At that time, about a third of all currency in circulation was counterfeit. There was no public confidence in the monetary system. This is at the end of the Civil War. So President Abraham Lincoln approved the creation of the U.S. Secret Service on April 14th, 1865. The Secret Service was put in the Department of Treasury. The Secret Service is one of the oldest federal law enforcement agencies, but it was created for counterfeit money investigations, not for presidential protection. Anybody know what happened on April 14th, 1865? Pretty ironic. Ironic that the day that President Lincoln signs the paperwork to create the Secret Service for counterfeit money investigations, that evening he'd go to Ford's Theater to watch Our American Cousin. So, fast forwarding in history, here we have, again, we still have no federal agency protecting the president on a full-time basis. We have local law enforcement wherever the president shows up. We have the military when they're there. So these are some incidents that happened. We have three presidents who are assassinated and one attempted. The attempted assassination was Andrew Jackson by Richard Lawrence, 1835. Of course, we have William McKinley by Leon Czolgosz, Lincoln by Booth, and of course, Garfield by Charles Guiteau. So, 1894, the Secret Service begins informal, occasional presidential security, starting with President Grover Cleveland. 1901, after President McKinley is assassinated, the Secret Service is given expanded part-time presidential protection responsibilities, beginning with Teddy Roosevelt. 1902, full-time presidential protection begins, and in 1906, Congress authorizes permanent protection duties for the president to the Secret Service. The Secret Service continue to do counterfeit money investigations, and even today, the U.S. Secret Service still conducts counterfeit money investigations. The Secret Service remained in the Department of Treasury for up until after 9/11, September 11th terrorist attacks, with the creation of the Department of Homeland Security that came after 9/11, 2001. The Secret Service was moved out of the Department of Treasury and put into the Department of Homeland Security. I'll just give you some other interesting dates. 1951 is when we began the protection of the vice president. 1961, protection of former presidents. And in 1968, protection of presidential candidates began the day after Senator Robert Kennedy was assassinated by Sirhan Sirhan. And of course, we're gearing up for presidential elections now in 2016. And you probably heard on the news that They've already picked up protection now for Donald Trump and Ben Carson, just began or is going to begin very shortly. I wanted to point out also that the Secret Service, the people that they protect, the places that they protect, is designated by federal law. It has to be in the federal law for us to have our protection duties. However, we all have heard a lot about executive orders lately about the president's use of executive orders, and all presidents use executive orders. But in protection, that's the way the president by an executive order can authorize the U.S. Secret Service to protect anybody if it's not covered by law. For example, I gave some of the recent examples when the last election in 2008, when Hillary Clinton was campaigning for president, Chelsea Clinton was out on the campaign trail. At that point, she was not entitled to presidential or Secret Service protection any longer because her father was now the former president, and she's an adult, so she did not qualify for Secret Service protection. And so what usually happens with these executive orders is that incidents start to happen, and as she was out on campaigning for her mother, she became the target of some threats and some incidents. And so the president signed an executive order that we temporarily protected Chelsea Clinton until the election was over. Also, after 9/11, the government, obviously, at that, thinking back of the amount of chaos that was done or going on at that time, the Secret Service was authorized to pick up protection on certain government officials for continuity of the government. And then also back in the 90s, when President George H.W. Bush was president, we had a lot of intelligence that they were going to try to kidnap one of his family members, particularly his grandchildren. And at the time, we had no protection on his grandchildren. And so by executive order, we picked up protection of the grandchildren. The Secret Service did extensive research on assassins after some close call incidents, and it's published in the Journal of Forensic Sciences, and it's known as the Secret Service Exceptional Case Study. So we looked at incidents between 1949 and 1995. Now, obviously, Garfield's assassination would not be included in this particular study because it starts at 1949. However, if you look at the results of this research and then you do look at the psychiatric autopsy of Charles Guiteau, the findings from the study, Guiteau fits very nicely in what we found in studying assassins in the Exceptional Case Study Project. And then the Exceptional Case Study Project came out, was published, and right after our assassin study was published, Columbine High School happened. And so the Secret Service went to the Department of Education right after the Columbine High School shooting and said, hey, we just finished this research on assassins. We have everything in place. Would you be interested in partnering up with us? We'll continue our research. And so it's known as the Safe School Initiative. The Secret Service looked at 37 incidents of student-led attacks between 1974 and 2000, involving 41 student attackers. Interesting thing about these two studies, going back to the Exceptional Case Study Project, this completely changed how the Secret Service did threat assessment and threat investigations. The results of that research caused us to rewrite our manuals, get retrained, and do totally new protocols based on the results of this study. Interesting thing about the school shooter study is the findings of the school shooters mirrored very closely the findings of the assassin study. So in other words, assassins and school shooters had very similar characteristics. I write about this, Chief Jim McBride, who was the campus chief of police here. I teamed up with him about a year or two ago, and we co-authored a book called K to PhD, School and Campus Shooting Awareness. I write two chapters in that book. One is outlining the research, those two research works from the Secret Service, the assassin study and the school shooter study. And then I do a chapter on threat assessment based on how the Secret Service does it and based on the results of that research. I wanted to, before I turn it over to Ben, I wanted to kind of, the research that I've done on this, and I'm going to throw this out there because I've been looking at this for a long time, and you guys probably know this, that when you look up research, not everybody agrees. Like, you'll read different sources and you read different facts. And so some of the things, you know, you question of who has the right facts. And what I do when I research the stuff is I look at the source and try to determine who I, in my personal opinion, believe is the better source. So some of this information, like I said, will come from the source that I felt was the most accurate. And I don't know if anyone has any disagreement with these facts or not, maybe from a different source. But I just throw this up there to show you that Garfield and Guiteau, what they had in common and what was different about them. They were both raised in the Midwest, both by a single parent. Guiteau lost his mother and Garfield lost his father. Here's the difference. Garfield's mother was encouraging and ever-present. Guiteau's father was bizarre and remote. They both were devout Christians who dabbled in preaching. They were both born poor, longed for education and a better life. They were both ardent Republicans, and they both enjoyed the song John Brown's Body, for whatever that's worth. So I'll turn it over to Ben for his part.
Thank you, Greg. It was an interesting last slide. Particularly, everything was almost the same except for how their parents treated them. Perhaps in some respect, Guiteau was the yin to Garfield's yang. As a volunteer interpreter at the James Garfield National Historic Site, one of the questions we often get is, why did Guiteau want to kill the president? And the answer is very, very deep, I believe. We can put it most simply by saying Guiteau was a deranged man, or he was a disgruntled office seeker. Both of those things actually kind of tie together, but just that simple statement alone doesn't do nearly enough of an explanation to it. And that was kind of the inspiration to me delving into some research. The title here, A Layman's Tour Inside the Mind of an Assassin. I just want to point out that I am not trained in psychology. I just kind of have an eclectic interest in research and history and sciences and biology and psychology. I just assembled a lot of different sources and talked to a couple of friends of mine who do have degrees in psychology, and we just kind of pulled our thoughts together and came up with what might be some plausible diagnoses about Guiteau's psychology. You'll forgive me if I rush through a lot of his biography just for the sake of time. I need to explain different snippets of his biography as we move through this. But these behavior points will support a symptom that I'm going to share here in the next several slides, and then the last couple will be trying to say, well, if these were the symptoms, perhaps these were the psychoses that he suffered. First off, we can pretty much believe that Charles Guiteau suffered from grandiose delusions. That is, believing that you are more important, that you are more skilled, that you are more knowledgeable than you actually are in reality. Guiteau believed that he was chosen by God to spread the gospel through a newspaper. He believed that God wanted him to publish his own newspaper that would be circulated nationwide and would spread the gospel of Christ. He believed that he was extremely skilled and gifted in this, and that would give him the opportunity to be a famous newspaper publisher. And he would try and use that belief to secure financing. He unfortunately was never able to get it, unfortunate for himself, he was never able to actually secure any financing. So this was just another fly-by-night type of scheme that he had developed. Guiteau also believed that he had very, very high political connections and that these connections would lead to important government appointments. One of those connections and appointments that he believed he could get was because of this imaginary woman that he believed that he was engaged with. He would actually tell President Garfield and Secretary of State James Blaine that he is engaged to a very wealthy socialite in Washington, very well-known woman, and that the two of them would make very good counselors in Vienna. This woman really either didn't exist, or Guiteau happened to meet her once, maybe shake her hand, but if she existed, she almost assuredly did not know him. He confessed to the shooting without any kind of delay. As soon as he was walking out of the Baltimore and Ohio train station, he approached a City of Washington police officer and said, "Yeah, I did it. I just shot the president. I'm going to go to jail for it. And Arthur is now going to be the president." He believed that that shooting the president was justified because of Garfield's corruption. He believed that he was being cheated. Guiteau believed he was being cheated out of government positions or government jobs, and that for the good of the republic, that the president must be removed. So he was very proud of this. He believed that he was a savior to our nation and that he would prevent another bloody civil war. He writes a letter before the shooting addressed to General William Sherman, William Tecumseh Sherman. And it basically says, "General, please call out your troops and secure the city jail because that's where I'm going to be held. And once news of my accomplishment gets out, there's going to be a major riot. They're going to storm the jail to free me. And surely some of the other prisoners are going to get out too. And you don't want those crazy loons getting out of jail. Secure the jail for the city's protection." As he was waiting his trial, he is expecting to profit on his infamy. A photographer comes in and asks to take photographs of him. And he says, "Well, sure, but make sure you get my good side." Guiteau believed that any moment now, Chester Arthur, President Arthur, would be pardoning Guiteau, that Guiteau would be able to engage on a speaking tour across the country, talking about his experience and how he saved the nation from corrupt Garfield. Guiteau exhibits a lot of narcissistic behaviors as well, similar to grandiose delusions, but this one is more specific to your own personal being. You are better, you are more important than others. Again, chosen by God, he is the publisher that is going to spread the gospel, that he is a famous theologian. When he arrives in various cities as he travels the country attempting to make money, he comes into town and says, "I am Charles Guiteau. I am a famous traveling theologian. I will be presenting a speech at 5 o'clock at the town square. Please come out and see me, the famous theologian, Charles Guiteau." He also, once he moves on to the city of Washington, expecting that job inside the government, he starts loitering in the high-end hotels. He can only afford to stay in the lower-end hotels. Most of the time, he's not even affording that. He's skipping out on the boarding bills. But he's loitering and using the stationery of the high-end hotels in order to write his letters because it looks better. You can use the Willard Hotel as your place of residence, and it sounds better than Ben's hotel on the other side of town. In addition to cashing in on his infamy, he expects that he will be able to earn a wife out of killing the president. So one of the letters he's writing while in jail waiting trial is that he wants a refined woman of social class to be his new bride. And he states a variety of different characteristics that he's looking for. But again, he believes so much that he has done something great that he should be able to pick and choose the woman that will be with him. And then once he is finally about to be executed, he believes and expects divine revenge to be cast down on the American people by God himself for having the audacity to execute the man that killed the corrupt Garfield. Kitto does exhibit, for as much as we can detest him, he does exhibit some more sympathetic behaviors as well. His desire for belongingness, that is to be included in positive social relationships. He's fascinated, almost obsessed with the Oneida community in upstate New York. His repeated attempts to return that community after he leaves them. Please take me back, bring me back in. I want to be a part of this community. I can do better this time. He does marry. He marries a woman named Annie Bunn. And he wants to have a wife, but he is very abusive and very dangerous to her. Social rejection is the counterpart of belongingness, the fear of being isolated or rejected by your peers. This kind of leads to a lot of moody and erratic behaviors. He's consistently abandoning social environments that should be positive. Again, he consistently leaves the Oneida community because he believes they're being rude to him. He enrolls in college, but doesn't feel like he fits in very well. So after just a couple of months at the University of Michigan, he quits. He leaves because he's not fitting in very well. Eventually, he decides that in order to accomplish all of his goals in life, that, it's probably just better to be alone so that he can avoid distraction. Without friends and girlfriends getting in the way, he can be that famous theologian. He can be that famous and prominent newspaper editor. Confabulations are distorted or misinterpretation of memories, but without the direct intent to deceive. A lot of the lectures that he delivers while being a traveling theologian are really just plagiarisms from a book called The Berean, which was published by the leader of the Oneida community. Derailment is where you have disconnected thinking of thoughts. You switch among unrelated topics very easily. The speeches that he would deliver as that traveling theologian were very disorganized ramblings. They're very difficult to follow. Attendees would show up and pay their 50 cents or whatever, and then after 15 minutes of shuffling papers and mumbling to himself and hardly speaking much at all, he would just exit the podium. Charles Kitto also exhibits a lot of paranoia behaviors. One of the practices at the Oneida community is to basically have social criticisms of each other. In order to improve ourselves, we must subject ourselves to criticisms from our peers. Kitto hated these opportunities. He hated these meetings. He began to believe that the members of the community had it out for him. The New York Herald had published an article against him talking about fraudulent practices as a lawyer. Kitto believed that, again, the Herald was out to ruin his life, ruin his reputation, and he doesn't attempt to file a lawsuit against them. While he is hanging around in the State Department under the administration of President Garfield, Kitto is sent on errands. Now, these probably are fool's errands. Eventually, Kitto begins to cue into this, and every time he gets an opportunity to meet with anyone, he immediately begins to suspect that it is going to be a fool's errand, that this person is not actually out to help him, but to make fun of him. And then, of course, the corruption of President Garfield and Secretary of State James Blaine. And Lastly, the antisocial behavior that he exhibits, harmful actions without consideration of the effect on others. Now, antisocial behavior is not that you don't want to be with people or around people. You just have no empathy about how your actions impact them. He was cruel and abusive to his wife. He would skip out on the bills, the removal of the president, collecting only his commission on a debt that he is charged by some businessman to collect. The debt is $100. Guiteau's half would be $50, so he finds the debtor and says, well, pay me the $50 and we'll call it even. He just skips out and leaves the businessman short $50. We can take all of these items together and start to assemble a possible psychosis. And the first one I think we can come up with is mania or bipolar. And this would be supported by grandiose delusions and the sense for belongingness, an inflated self-esteem, flights of ideas, goal-directed activity. He became laser-focused on anything that he would catch his attention on. The problem is that most of the time, this would only be for a very short amount of time. He also then had an excessive fixation on the activities that have a high degree of consequence. The lawsuit against the New York Herald, very unlikely to succeed, but he obsessed over it. He attempted to work with the state legislature of New York to break up the Oneida community. He obsessed over this, and this was something that really had no opportunity to succeed. Paranoid schizophrenia is probably also another symptom that Guiteau suffers. Again, the grandiose delusions, confabulation, derailment, and paranoia, the disorganized speech or patterns of thought, and social isolation are supportive behaviors. Narcissistic personality disorder is certainly supported by the narcissism, and there's various types of narcissism, in this case probably unprincipled narcissism. His sense for belongingness, fear of social rejection, antisocial personality disorder, these are all supported by deficient conscience. He's unscrupulous in his behavior. He's skipping out on his boarding bills, on his printing bills. He might board a train without a ticket and be caught 20 miles down the track. What does it matter to him? He just got a free ride for 20 miles. Fraudulent and vindictive behavior as well. So we can kind of form a little bit more of a sense of understanding about why it's not quite enough to say Charles Guiteau was a deranged man. Unfortunately, we can't know for sure. All of these psychoses are modern understandings of psychiatry. But by taking his background and certain points of his life, we can start to formulate an idea and come up with what perhaps Charles Guiteau may have been suffering from when he assassinated President Garfield.
Are any of you familiar with the play Assassins? Okay. 1977, an individual named Charles Gilbert Jr. He was a young director and composer, fresh out of grad school. He was searching for a subject for an original work. He read a library collection of biographical sketches of individuals who had either killed or attempted to kill an American president and why, as told in their own words. He wrote a stage production showing the dark side of the American dream and contemplating the thin line that separates the assassin from the average American. In the spring of 1988, Gilbert was contacted by Stephen Sondheim, who wanted permission to revive the idea as a musical play. In 2004, it appeared on Broadway. It won 5 Tony Awards, and if you've ever get a chance to see this production, because college campuses, we did it here at Lakeland, and college campuses will do it, or community theaters will do it, and I remember the first time I saw it, when I was still in the Secret Service, I was like, wow, I learned that in school. I learned that in school. I learned that in school. Because they wrote the play, and think about this, a musical about assassins. They wrote the play based on factual information. Now, there's there's obviously some poetic license, and there are things that are not real in it, but a lot of the dialogue is actually from fact. Now, the one thing that here are the nine assassins that the play is about. Now, the one thing that obviously is not possible is that all of these assassins interact with each other throughout the play. So I want to show you a clip from Lakeland's production of Assassins. And if any of you have read about Guiteau, he wrote a lot, especially when he was in prison awaiting trial. And he wrote poems, and he wrote a poem called "I'm Going to the Lordy," if anyone's familiar about reading about Guiteau. So they take the words of the poem that he wrote, and Stephen Sondheim turns this into a musical piece in the play.
The problem is your feet. To shoot well, you have to plant your feet firmly and hold up the gun with a straight, stiff arm. Here, let me show you. First the feet. Then the arm.
Like this?
Mm-hmm. Oh. You know, you're a very handsome woman.
Thank you.
How would you like to be the wife of the ambassador to France?
That would be nice.
Come, let me steal a kiss.
I don't think so.
Oh, one little kiss.
Stop!
Ah, a coquette, huh?
Let go of me!
I want a kiss!
Ah! Are you all right?
I am more than all right! I am extraordinary! I am to be reckoned with! I am the next ambassador to France!
Your train is on track 6, Mr. President.
President Garfield!
Yes?
I want to be ambassador to France.
I'm sorry?
I want to be ambassador to France.
Mad as a hatter.
No, 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 no! The Lordy, I am so glad. I am going to the Lordy. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah! I am going to the Lordy.
Come all ye Christians and learn from a sinner, Charlie Guiteau. Bound and determined he'd wind up a winner. Charlie had dreams that he wouldn't let go. Said nothing to it, I want it, I'll do it, I'm Charles J. Guiteau. Charlie Guiteau never said never or heard the word no. When faced with disaster, his heart would beat faster, his smile would just grow. And he'd say,
look on the bright side, look on the bright side, sit on the right side of the Lord. This is the land of opportunity. He is the lightning, you're his sword. Wait till you see tomorrow. Tomorrow you'll get your reward. You can be sad, or you can be president. Look on the bright side. I am going to the Lordy.
Charlie Gitto drew a crowd to his trial. He led them in prayer. Said, I killed Garfield, I'll make no denial. I was just acting for someone up there. The Lord's my employer, and now he's my lawyer, so do what you dare. Charlie said, hell, if I am guilty, then God is as well. But God was acquitted, and Charlie committed until he should hang. Still he sang.
Look on the bright side, not on the black side. Get off your backside, shine those shoes. This is your golden opportunity. You are the lightning and your news. Wait till you see tomorrow. Tomorrow you won't be ignored. You can be pardoned or you can be president. Look on the bright side. I am going to the Lord East.
Charlie Gitto drew a crowd to the scaffold. He filled up the square. So many people that tickets were raffled. Shine on his shoes, Charlie mounted the stair. Said never sorrow, just wait till tomorrow. Today isn't fair. Don't despair.
Look on the bright side. Look on the bright side. Sit on the right side of the... I am going to the Lordy. I am so glad. I am going to the Lordy. I am so glad. I have unified my party. I have saved my country. I shall be remembered. I am going to the Lordy.
Look on the bright side, not on the sad side. Inside the bad side, something's good. This is your golden opportunity. You've been a preacher.
Yes, I have.
You've been an author.
Yes, I have.
You've been a killer.
Yes, I have.
You could be an angel.
Yes, I could.
Wait until tomorrow. Tomorrow they'll all climb aboard. What if you never got to be president? You'll be remembered.
Yes.
Look on the bright side.
Yes.
Trust in tomorrow and the Lord.
Okay, so Assassins, Charles Gitto. That's all we have. If you have any questions of either of us.
Just two points I'd like to make. I would agree with most of the assassins or attempted assassins, with the exception of Booth. I don't think he fits the profile of the rest of those people. He was the most successful actor during his time. He made an enormous amount of money for what he did. He had no reason to give it up except for what? Because he thought Lincoln was an evil man, and he was going to be a hero on the side.
Well, Booth thought that he was, he's similar to Gitto in that he thought he was doing the country a favor. He did not think he was going to be viewed as a...
He didn't suffer from illusions of grandeur. He didn't have a psychosis as such. He was a successful actor. He had a career. He had a fiance, a woman he was going to marry. He had the world by the tail. He had no reason.
John, I think we would see that as a sign of success. We would see that Booth was a success. He didn't necessarily see himself that way. He saw himself as an avenger of a lost cause, as which was delusions of grandeur. He was present at John Brown's hanging because he didn't necessarily want to join the militia or the military. That was the theme of his whole life. But his mother had told him what a great... We think of him as a success. Booth was a success in ordinary terms. But maybe to him, because I think he suffered from a certain amount of psychosis, he didn't see himself that way. And I think that's the thread that goes through these whole things. You know, we don't know, we may see these people as successful individuals, but they don't see themselves that way. Or they want to see themselves as more than they actually are, or more than is realistically possible. Do you see what I'm saying, John, in this instance there?
Remember what...
He was.
Remember what Booth yelled...
I see your point, but I don't agree.
Oh. Remember what Booth yelled when he shot Lincoln and jumped onto the stage, Sig Semper Tyrannis? You know?
Booth, I haven't done nearly as much research on Booth as I did on Guiteau, obviously, but I think Booth is exhibiting certain behaviors that would be consistent with narcissism. Contemporary reports would indicate that Booth was flabbergasted that he couldn't believe even Southern newspapers were calling him a scoundrel. Everyone knew Booth did it. He wanted everyone to know that he did it. And he was expecting a great deal of infamy out of it. He was expecting to be praised as a hero, not just in the South, but in the North as well. And he was completely surprised that when the Southern populace, whom he did this act for, turned against him.
Any other questions? Last question.
On the Secret Service protection, it's my understanding that at least certain people are not allowed to refuse Secret Service protection. At least, maybe, I assume, the ones authorized by law. But what if the president were to, through executive order, assign protection to an individual who would rather refuse it? Is there a way? Like, can the president authorize something that they cannot refuse?
If they don't want it, they don't have to have it. I'll give you the perfect example. President Nixon, as a former president, was entitled to Secret Service protection. President Nixon, we all know how he left office, he decided that he would not spend the government money, because there's always articles written about how much money it costs to protect former presidents. Jimmy Carter, still living, H.W. Bush, you know, it's very expensive. Well, Nixon, as a former president, was entitled to protection, and when he left, he didn't have it. Because he
would not have been able to refuse.
I'm sorry?
When he was president, Nixon...
No, as a president, you can't refuse it. But you bring up a point that we often have problems with. Do we sit down with the president and the president's staff and say, the president will tell us they want to go somewhere, and we say, you know, we don't think that's a good idea. But if they say they're going... Now, there have been times, a couple times, when the Secret Service has been able to say, it's just not safe. But you guys know George W. went into Afghanistan and Iraq for visits. So it can be done. Nobody knew, you know, it was all stealth kind of things.
I thank you for your time. Please remember to fill out your evaluation.